going to read to you from More About Paddington, Part 2. About the first part, Paddington fell into the flower beds with the petunias of Mr. Brown because his face was stuck into the camera. "I should be careful, Dad," said Jonathan at Mr. Brown, as Mr. Brown began pulling at Paddington's legs. His whiskers might be caught in the shutter. Mr. Brown stopped pulling and crawled round to peer through the lens. "I can't see anything," he said after a moment's pause. "It's all dark inside." He tapped the case and there came another faint cry from within. "Better," said Mrs. Bird, hurrying towards the kitchen. "There's nothing like butter when anyone's stuck." Mrs. Bird was a great believer in butter. She had used it several times in the past when Paddington had got himself stuck. All the same, even with Jonathan holding one end and Mr. Brown pulling on the other, it was some while before Paddington's head finally came away from the camera. He sat on the grass, rubbing his ears and looking very crestfallen. Things hadn't got at all according to plan. "I vote," said Mr. Brown when order had finally been restored, "that we set everything up exactly as it was before and tie a string to the shutter. Then Paddington can sit in the group with us and work it from a distance. It'll be much safer that way." Everyone agreed that this was a good idea. And while Mr. Brown arranged the group once again, Paddington busied himself setting up his camera and fitting the photographic plate inside it, making sure to stand well back this time. There was a slight setback when he pulled the string too hard and the tripod fell over, but finally the big moment arrived. There was a click from the camera and everyone relaxed. The man in the photographic shop looked most surprised when Mrs. Bird, all the Browns and Paddington trooped in through the door a little later. "It is certainly a very rare sort," he said, examining Paddington's camera with interest. "Very rare. I've read about them, of course, but I've never actually seen one before." It must have been kept in a pantry or something. It seems to have a lot of butter inside it." "I had a bit of an accident when I tried to put the plate in," said Paddington. "We're all very anxious to see the result of the photograph," added Mr. Brown hastily. "We were wondering if you could do it for us while we wait." The man said he would be only too pleased to oblige. From all he had seen and heard, he was quite eager to see the picture, and he hurried off to his dark room, leaving the Browns alone in the shop. He couldn't remember ever having a young bear photographer in the shop before. "I'm trying to drink my coffee at a 90 degree angle. It's very hard." So the man in the shop couldn't remember ever having a young bear photographer in the shop before. When he returned, there was a puzzled expression on his face. "You did say you took this picture today?" he asked, looking through the window at the bright sunshine. "That's right." said Paddington, eyeing him suspiciously. "Well, sir," the man held the plate up to the light for Paddington to see. "It's nice and sharp, and I can certainly see you all, but it looks as if it was foggy all the time. And these patches of light like moonbeams, they are very odd." Paddington took the plate from the man and examined it carefully. "I expect that's where I had my torch on, under the bedclothes," he said at last. "Well, I think it's a very nice picture for a first attempt," said Mrs. Bird, "and I'd like 6 postcard prints, please. I'm sure Paddington's Aunt Lucy in Peru would love one. She lives in the home for retired bears in Lima," she added, for the benefit of the shopkeeper. "Does she?" said the man, looking most impressed. "Well, it's the first time I've ever had any pictures sent overseas, especially to a home for retired bears in Peru." He thought for a moment. "I tell you what," he said, "if I could borrow this camera for a week to put in my shop window, I'll not only do all the prints you want, but I'll take a photograph of each of you into the bargain. How's that?" "I might have known," said Mr. Brown, as they were walking home, "that if Paddington took our photographs, something odd would happen. Fancy getting all these pictures for nothing." "Bears always fall on their feet," said Mrs. Bird, looking at Paddington. But Paddington wasn't listening. He was still thinking about his camera. Early next morning, he hurried down to the shop and was pleased to see it already occupied a position of honor in the middle of the window. Underneath it was a notice which said, "A very rare type of early camera, now owned by Mr. Paddington Brown, a young local bear gentleman." But Paddington was even more pleased by another notice next to it, which said, "An example of his work," and underneath that was his picture. It was a little blurred, and there were several paw marks near the edge, but one or two people in the neighborhood came up and congratulated him, and several of them said they could quite clearly recognize everyone in it. All in all, Paddington thought it had been a very good 3 and 6 pence worth. Chapter 2. A Spot of Decorating. Paddington gave a deep sigh and pulled his head down over his ears in an effort to keep out the noise. There was such a hullabaloo going on. It was difficult to write up the notes in his scrapbook. The excitement had all started when Mr. and Mrs. Brown and Mrs. Bird received an unexpected invitation to a wedding. Luckily, both Jonathan and Judy were out for the day, or things might have been far worse. Paddington hadn't been included in the invitation, but he didn't really mind. He didn't like weddings very much, apart from the free cake. And he'd been promised a piece of that whether he went or not. All the same, he was beginning to wish everyone would hurry up and go. He had a special reason for wanting to be alone that day. He sighed again, wiped the pen carefully on the back of his paw, and then mopped up some ink blots which somehow or other had found their way onto the table. He was only just in time, for at that moment the door burst open and Mrs. Brown rushed in. "Ah, there you are, Paddington." She stopped short in the middle of the room and stared at him. "Why on earth are you wearing your hat indoors?" she asked. "And why is your tongue all blue?" Paddington stuck out his tongue as far as he could. "It is a funny color," he admitted, squinting down at it with interest. "Perhaps I'm sickening for something." "You will be sickening for something, all right, if you don't clear up this mess," grumbled Mrs. Bird as she entered. "Just look at it. Bottles of ink, glue, bits of paper, my best sewing scissors, marmalade all over the table runner, and goodness knows what else." Paddington looked around. It was in a bit of a state. I've almost finished, he announced. I've just got to roll a few more lines and things. I've been writing my memories. Paddington took his scrapbook very seriously and spent many long hours carefully pasting in pictures and writing up his adventures. Since he'd been at the Browns, so much had happened, it was now more than half full. Well, make sure you do clear up everything, said Mrs. Brown, or we shan't bring you back any cake. Now do take care of yourself, and don't forget, when the baker comes, we want two loaves. With that, she waved goodbye and followed Mrs. Bird out of the room. You know, said Mrs. Bird as she stepped into the car, I have a feeling that Bear has something up his paw. He seemed most anxious for us to leave. Oh, I don't know, said Mrs. Brown. I don't see what he can do. We shan't be away all that long. Ah, replied Mrs. Bird darkly, that's as may be. But he's been hanging about on the landing upstairs half the morning. I'm sure he's up to something. Mr. Brown, who didn't like weddings much either, and was secretly wishing he could stay at home with Paddington, looked over his shoulder as he let in the clutch. Perhaps I ought to stay as well, he said, then I could get on with decorating his new room. Now, Henry, said Mrs. Brown firmly, you're coming to the wedding, and that's that. Paddington will be quite all right by himself. He's a very capable bear. And as for you wanting to get on with decorating his new room? You haven't done a thing towards it for over a fortnight, so I'm sure it can wait another day. Paddington's new room had become a sore point in the Brown household. It was over 2 weeks since Mr. Brown had first thought of doing it. So far he had stripped all the old wallpaper from the walls, removed the picture rails, the wood round the doors, the door handle, and everything else that was loose, or that he had made loose, and bought a lot of bright, new wallpaper. Some whitewash and some paint. There matters had rested. In the back of the car, Mrs. Bird pretended she hadn't heard a thing. An idea had suddenly come into her mind, and she was hoping it hadn't entered Paddington's as well. But Mrs. Bird knew the workings of Paddington's mind better than most, and she feared the worst. Had she but known her fears were being realized at that very moment. Paddington was busy scratching out the words at a loose end in his scrapbook, and was adding in large capital letters the ominous ones, decorating my new room. It was while he'd been writing at a loose end in his scrapbook earlier in the day that an idea had come to him. Paddington had noticed in the past that he often got his best ideas when he was at a loose end. For a long while, all his belongings had been packed away, ready for the big move to his new room, and he was beginning to get impatient. Every time he wanted anything special, he had to undo yards of string and brown paper. Having underlined the words in red, Paddington cleared everything up locked his scrapbook carefully in his suitcase and hurried upstairs. He had several times offered to lend a paw with the decorating, but for some reason or other Mr. Brown had put his foot down on the idea and hadn't even allowed him in the room while work was in progress. Paddington couldn't quite understand why. He was sure he would be very good at it. The room in question was an old box room, which had been out of use for a number of years, and when he entered it, Paddington found it was even more interesting than he had expected. He closed the door carefully behind him and sniffed. There was an exciting smell of paint and whitewash in the air. Not only that, but there were some steps, a trestle table, several brushes, a number of rolls of wallpaper, and a big pail of whitewash. The room had a lovely echo as well. And he spent a long time sitting in the middle of the floor while he was stirring the paint, just listening to his new voice. There were so many different and interesting things around that it was a job to know what to do first. Eventually, Paddington decided on the painting. Choosing one of Mr. Brown's best brushes, he dipped it into the pot of paint and then looked around the room for something to dab it on. It wasn't until he had been working on the window frame for several minutes that he began to wish he had started on something else. The brush made his arm ache, and when he tried dipping his paw in the paint pot instead and rubbing it on, more paint seemed to go onto the glass than the wooden part, so that the room became quite dark. "Perhaps," said Paddington, waving the brush in the air and addressing the room in general, "perhaps if I do the ceiling first with the whitewash, I can cover all the drips on the wall with the wallpaper." But when when Paddington started work on the whitewashing, he found it was almost as hard as painting. Even by standing on tiptoe at the very top of the steps, he had a job to reach the ceiling. The bucket of whitewash was much too heavy for him to lift, so that he had to come down the steps every time in order to dip the brush in it. And when he carried the brush up again, the whitewash ran down his paw and made his fur all matted. Looking around him, Paddington began to wish he was still at a loose end. Things were beginning to get in rather a mess again. He felt sure Mrs. Bird would have something to say when she saw it. It was then that he had a brainwave. Paddington was a resourceful bear, and he didn't like being beaten by things, just like me. Recently, he had become interested in a house which was being built nearby. He had first seen it from the window of his bedroom, and since then he'd spent many hours talking to the men and watching while they hoisted their tools and cement up to the top floor by means of a rope and a pulley. Once Mr. Briggs, the foreman, had even taken him up in the bucket too and had let him lay several bricks. Now the Brown's house was an old one, and in the middle of the ceiling there was a large hook where a big lamp had once hung. Not only that, but in one corner of the room there was a thin coil of rope as well. Paddington set to work quickly. First he tied one end of the rope to the handle of the bucket. Then he climbed up the steps and passed the other end through the hook in the ceiling. But even so, when he had climbed down again, it still took him a long time to pull the bucket anywhere near the top of the steps. It was full to the brim with whitewash and very heavy, so that he had to stop every few seconds and tie the other end of the rope to the steps for safety. It was when he undid the rope for the last time that things started to go wrong. As Paddington closed his eyes and leaned back for the final pull, he suddenly felt, to his surprise, as if he was floating on air. It was a most strange feeling. He reached out one foot and waved it around. There was definitely nothing there. He opened one eye and then nearby let go of the rope in astonishment as he saw the bucket of whitewash going past him on its way down. Suddenly everything seemed to happen at once. Before he could even reach out a paw or shout for help, his head hit the ceiling and there was a clang as the bucket hit the floor. This is the end of part 2 of More About Paddington, read by Marion.